Well, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name is TJ Kelly. I will be your moderator for today's discussion. Today's topic is the state of corporate security, a 2022 mid-year review. In this discussion, our panel will look back at RaceSecure's annual State of Mail Security Report. We'll review the statistics and predictions we made earlier this year. We'll provide updates and analysis on that, that data. And we'll talk about general security trends so far in 2022. Joining us to discuss this topic is our panel of experts. First, we have Carlos Francisco. Carlos is a global security leader, a corporate security executive, an author, speaker, podcaster, former law enforcement officer, and all-around career security professional. Carlos, thank you for joining us today.
Excited to be here, bud. Let's do it.
Let's do it. And then we have Will Plum, our Chief Security Officer with RaceSecure. Will is the director of our EOD Secure program, a 25-year veteran of the U.S. Army and a master EOD technician. Will, thank you for being here today.
Thanks, TJ. It'll be fun.
So our agenda today, we will cover the review of that report. We'll talk about our mid-year statistics covering January through June of this year and how well they align to what the predictions made looking at 2021's data. And then we'll have an open discussion of the 2022 security threats, including mail and all-around security, mail and otherwise. We will have time for a Q&A at the end, so please do submit your questions into the box here in Zoom. We'll get to those questions. I'll read them aloud, so feel free to throw anything in there. We'll keep those anonymous and throw those out to the panel. Before we dive in, a quick introduction to who we are. If you're unfamiliar with RaceSecure, we are the world leader in mail security, headquartered in Boston, Massachusetts, experts in mail threat detection and real-time analysis and support. And so what I would like to do is just walk through the report that we released earlier this year. If you were on that webinar, hopefully you got to learn some of that data, but we'll review it, refresh the memory a little bit. So on this report, and by the way, we'll give out a copy of this for anyone who hasn't had it yet. But what we did is we provided some key findings of mail security data. The big numbers you can see here on the screen, 89% of the mail threats that we were able to collect, and Will, I'm sure you can talk about this data, were delivered via small letter and parcels, right? There's this understanding out there, this idea that it's in these big boxes, big pallets. It's really not the case when it comes to mail security threats. And like I said, Will can help us analyze some of that. Another interesting stat is that more than half of the mail security problems that we were able to report on last year were in the form of white powder or illegal drugs. And I believe that's a big increase from the previous year. So, Will, if you would take us through some of that stuff. We see some trends that were creeping upward toward the end of last year, including the intent of harm, right? Toxicity of some of the powders. The threats were getting more serious as we moved into late last year. Including those drugs. And like we'll talk about, politics and sort of the world events have pretty big impact here. So unfortunately, we saw a lot of racial and ethnic groups being targeted. We'll talk about the continuation of any of that. And obviously, political figures get wrapped up into that as well. And then the driving factors, right? Mistrust in the government. And there's been no shortage of that lately as well. So this is what you'll find in that report. We're happy to give that out for folks who are interested to see that report at the end of today's event. So as we move on here, Will, I'd like to bring you in to talk a little bit about, where we kind of see numbers in 2021 and what those predictions are going to look like into 2022, right? Obviously, COVID was a major driving factor last year, the year before. We mentioned government and that kind of stuff. So what can you tell us so far about some of these things, predictions and findings last year and into this year?
So a few things we looked at. About the time the new year rolled through, COVID was still a significant issue and companies were trying to figure out how to deal with it. Everybody was still primarily working remote. What we found in the last 6 months is threats regarding COVID mandates and all those things, they've kind of backed off, which is to be expected. There are some incidents that have popped up that are tied to it, but most of the response where corporations were being dealt with that were not in the medical field, they've fallen off in the last 6 months. The increased aggressiveness that we talked about towards the government, both the state and federal, that's actually risen significantly. And we get to the numbers in a minute, you'll see that's been a problem. And I know Carlos and I are going to talk about this a little bit about, you have to watch what the government's doing because it does tie to your corporate environment. There's reactions and counter reactions that come from that. And then the racist extremist activities, that is absolutely on the rise. Smaller government agencies, NGOs, anybody that's trying to represent smaller organizations or smaller groups of people, they have been targeted recently as well. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to talk about the numbers. I'm a huge numbers person. I like to know why we're doing something. And it's really hard to look at mail threats and look at what shows up inside of companies getting numbers without kind of tracking open source, because and Carlos will agree with this a little bit. Nobody raises their hand and says, I've got a problem. They don't want to make sure they bring attention to it. So what we see is what gets out in the public eye and gets in the public sector, obviously, because we're going to talk about our clients. So a couple interesting things for the first 6 months. Drugs have increased significantly. So they've absolutely, and this is for international, they've been pushing, a lot of trafficking has been happening. A lot of drugs coming through Mexico and China. Fentanyl is rolling through quite heavily. Governments are being targeted. There's a huge issue right now going on with Ukraine, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, and the fallout that Russian embassies are having from it. But overall, the North American threats have risen. That's Canada has taken quite a few threats recently, but they're shifting. So we're at a transition year, at least it looks like when you track the last 3 or 4 years in stats. This transition year is going into hopefully some form of stability, but it doesn't look like it from the way the numbers are playing out. Everything has risen, and some of the stuff that's dropped is residences, obviously, because people are more often in the workplace. But internationally, a lot of drugs and a lot of moving threats and parts and pieces for new places in the world. Here in the States, a little bit of an increase in business. They've been targeted a bit more because people are going back to the office, and we're seeing more and more where there's a push to get everybody back in behind desks. The courts and corrections has seen a significant increase, and that is interesting. Now, that's got to do with everything going into prisons. That's got to do with what's going towards judges, towards lawyers. A lot of this has been driven from the January 6th event, because that's still ongoing, and you get people from, whatever side they're on, having a way that they can get out their frustrations through the mail. Education's fallen. I think a lot of the stuff that happened last year, went back and take a look at it, where education had risen from previous years. That was most likely tied to people trying to get out of school, like the old pull the fire alarm trick. Just send some white powder in, we're gonna shut this place down for a while and not have to go in as people were returning. And then religious has fallen off a little bit. Again, that might be a trend that pick up in the second half of the year, but it's less than it was last year. Federal government sticking about the same, which was high last year as well because of what was going on with COVID mandates, but that's still higher than it has been in the two previous years. So what's actually in the mail? What's actually been showing up? Letter threats in the last 45, 60 days have increased. We'll talk about some incidents in a little bit, trying to drag each one of them out independently. But if you look at what people can do and they realize that I can send a tweet because I'm angry and nobody answers. I can send an email, it hits a firewall and nobody answers. One of the next steps they do is send a letter. And we talked about this before, but in the last 45 to 60 days, it's been a significant method of attack for people want to send in with their frustrations. Illegal drugs have gone up significantly from where we were at last year. And it's gone up a lot of places, the workplace. We'll talk about this in a little bit, but if you are sitting at the house and your spouse knows you have a problem and your business, because of porch pirates and because of what you do, allows somebody to just ship everything to the office, well, your illicit problem might shift to the office as well. And it's something to pay attention to. White powders have dropped, and a lot of that, who knows why, but they've been hitting significant targets, but it's not been such a widespread issue. I would stick with that. We wrote this a little bit ago, but in the last 7 days, we had one day, Tuesday, that had three events. So it's kind of hit or miss. And then the IED threat has been staying steady. So we like to look at actually trends to what happens in society and see what the responses and the reactions are. So if you walk this thing across left to right, Russia invades Ukraine, governments are getting hit. Some of these are rolled up with international numbers. So you end up with the embassies around the world where people want to get out their frustrations on what Russia's doing to Ukraine. And then we've had a lot of social change inside the United States recently. The states changed the rights laws. I couldn't figure out a better way to say that, but that's in some of the southern states, they've been changing what has been a social norm for a while. And you see reactions, people going after the state and local government because the elected leaders are making significant changes. And then you just walk it down to the right and you watch what happened with Roe v. Wade and responses to threats. I will tell you something, some interesting stuff, like after the Roe v. Wade was overturned, I think within 2.5 days, all the Supreme Court justices' addresses, whether they were right or wrong, they all had social media and people saying, mail it in, send them threats. And that's the response that we're getting in many of the state and local government issues. And again, we'll talk about why that matters for corporations here in a little bit. So
go ahead, Will. So, I think if we take this into the drivers behind, right, we get into the social unrest and some of these changes you're talking about, but if you could expand on some of that for us and take us through what's driving some of these things.
Yep. So both sides, Roe v. Wade, it does, and Carlos, I'm going to ask you to jump on here in a minute, in a second, but Roe v. Wade drove a lot of emotional reaction. And if you look at something like escalation of violence or workplace violence or whatever else, we want to talk about that we have to deal with as security professionals, this pushes people to do things. Again, that tweet doesn't go anywhere. That email doesn't go anywhere. But I could send a physical package to tell somebody what I think. 25 GOP lawmakers all received feces in the same day. That all were caught, but that's somebody making an actual statement going towards our government. If you tie this to what happens to local or to corporations, it kind of, the reaction they have is what we have to worry about dealing with in our world. So what do you think, Carlos?
Yeah, so here's a couple of things, Will, and we talked a little bit about this earlier. The biggest challenge I think today that I'm seeing on the corporate side is that a lot of corporations are aligning themselves with the politics of the world. And with that comes the same issues that you may get as you see here with the GOP lawmakers here getting feces. Well, you're seeing those same issues in the corporate side. So the more and more we get involved in the politics of what's going on in the world, the more and more in the security industry, in the corporate security world, we have to think about how we're going to protect all of the C-suites and everyone around us, including our employees, right down to our employees, including to the person that's receiving that mail or that box. And that's extremely important. So we have to be careful with that. If you're in a company that often speaks to that kind of stuff, yeah, the government, you gotta be aware of it for sure, man.
So we bring this up for a couple of reasons. If you look at it, it was overturned on a Thursday or a Friday. By that following Monday, I saw a list of Forbes that had 25 companies that all said they were going to pay for their employees' abortions and pay for travel, pay for everything else. That means it had already gone through the lawyers, that had gone through all of the company functions to get that press release completed. Companies are some of them are listed here. The reality is if you're working in the mailroom or you're working the security side of the house, you are now a target because of what your corporation decided to do. And to Carlos's point about quality of, responsibility, duty of care, that's critical. It's coming. We see these threats, they're rising right now. This happened primarily post the 6 months numbers that we're looking at. So we'll roll what happens up with this and at the end of the year, at the annual report. But companies are seeing events and they're seeing things come in because if I live in Omaha and I'm angry at somebody in California, I can't get there, I can mail it.
Yeah, absolutely, man. It's interesting as I'm looking at this roll of companies that you have here, they're huge. They're huge companies, Will. And so which becomes even a bigger target. This is not your mom and pop down the corner. These are big corporations. They're doing amazing things throughout the world that we really need to focus on. But like you said, if you're taking a stand, especially on Roe versus Wade, where you're allowing folks to move to different states or you're paying for them to go to other states to do what they need to do when it comes to abortion or pay for the abortion itself, you have to be careful or what's going to be coming in the mail, because it'll definitely go up as you showed a couple slides ago on how that comes up. And it looks like it, from what I was seeing, something happens 2 weeks later, approximately.
Yeah.
It's hitting your mailbox. So got to pay attention to that as a trend.
It is. That's a very good point. It's usually timely. When somebody gets released, it's usually 5 to 9 days is when it starts showing up in your mailroom. Good point.
But Will, how come it takes me forever, man, to mail something out just down to Florida to my mom? But no. I hear you, bud.
So the next thing we're looking at in January 6th is still going on. I mean, this is the third webinar that we brought this thing up since last year. You see what's going on in the news. You have the publicized congressional hearings and they're on mainstream sitting on prime time at night. People reacting, right? Both sides, everybody's heated. There's quite a bit of contention on what did or did not happen. And regardless of where you sit, that's not what we're here to talk about. The fallout from it is going to be critical to corporate success when you talk about security, because companies do the same thing with Roe v. Wade. They're doing it with their thoughts on some of these events. And a lot of the rollover goes back to people's hometowns, and it goes back to who they represent. And for example, this happened for Liz Cheney in Montana, but the effect is worldwide, or sorry, is across the United States. One of the issues that we'll see when you start looking at these hearings is those individuals that were all in, they were all involved, they were from all over the United States. So those federal courts everywhere are receiving threats. And I know we have people on this that are not in the corporate environment. They're in corrections and in the prison side of the house, but they're seeing threats that you normally only see in the DC area. Things that you would try to be taken care of for significant courts that are looking at major, major cases. These federal judges in the middle of wherever in, you know, middle America, they're seeing the problem too. And they're getting the same level threats that that some of the major ones are. It's kind of dispersed a little bit.
Yeah, another thing here, Will, I was just looking at a gentleman by the name of Ross Laverty. He was, you're talking about, he could come from almost anywhere. This guy was sending you know, feces and everything else to East Bay Homes, which is right here where I live. And he actually lived right here in the East Bay. So it could come from anywhere. If you're, you know, if you're, again, involved in a politics, people don't like you, you know, you might want to start thinking about these things more often than not. And another thing, Will, that we're talking about, corporations, usually with my emergency crisis management background, they're thinking about all these different things. And I always hear, oh, we got an active shooter training. And I always go, listen, I get more stuff in the mail that is suspicious, okay, than I'll ever get an active shooter. And so are we now focusing on the right things? You know, I'm in a data center world today. I get more power outages that are probably more crisis important to me than an active shooter. Are we focusing on those things? But I for sure get more of the mail issues, the things that smell, the things that go boom, the things that, you know, are wet, way more than I'd get the active shooter. So we have, once again, to pay attention to those things.
Yeah, absolutely. It's funny sometimes when you talk to people, their response is, I'll accept the pain. I'll pay the penalty when it happens. And it's usually, we'll talk about this at the end, like how to not have to accept the pain, you know, for, it's just fairly easy solutions. It's not hard to work on.
Yeah.
So we're going to talk about the Russia fallout and what's going on, you know, around the world, because that's, it's a flag that we can look at while we have other problems that kind of follow the same suit. So, you know, we talk about the Ukraine conflict, Russia invades, and well, what's Russia got around the world? They've got embassies. So around the world, their embassies have been receiving threats. This, again, goes back to the government problem. But what it's starting to prove is that it's more of a mainstream threat that people realize they can send in, because it's getting highlighted, it's getting repeated. You can expect to see these things happen again and again. I know none of us are going to be walking into a Russian embassy, but if it follows suit like other threats have, this is something that we can expect that will continue to increase. It's shown success. They keep emptying out embassies. They keep having problems. I'm going to start using this on other factors, especially when it comes to corporations that you can't touch. Some of these threats, we talked about the end of last year, the toxicity level of what was going on is increasing, and that's been holding true. Every presidential cabinet or White House since Bush Jr. has had ricin threats, either mailed to them or had them been delivered. Ricin's something that we have to worry about starting to show up as well. Usually in the later summer months is when it happens, and we have quite a bit of elections coming up. So if this has become a validated way to get after a major government, that might be something to think about, is we have major government events come up here again. And it's something that if you work in and around the government, you should be paying attention to.
And Will, I'm going to assume there's some corporate tie-in here to this as well, right? As we had corporations announcing they were pulling out of Russia, or some that refused to pull out of Russia, right? There's still a stance being made there, you know, and if there's an attachment by any particular actor or, you know, person who gets named in the news that happens to work for your corporation or is saying something about your corporation, you know, you don't have to work for one of these major, you know, giant corporations on earth. If you're a small mom and pop, like you call them, Carlos, but your name gets dragged into the news cycle all of a sudden, you know, your focus is on you, and there's ways to, you know, hopefully mitigate some of that. But I feel like this expands beyond just embassies, for example.
Oh, absolutely. And good catch, TG. I mean, people are making stances. Companies are moving exactly like you said. They're, you know, look at major fast food companies that no longer have a footprint there. They've pulled out. That's a statement. And I totally agree with that point. I should have brought that up. Thanks.
And I'll also add on that this whole entire geopolitical issue, as we become more of a global business, so, you know, a lot of the global companies now are becoming, I mean, truly global, where they're almost in every single country. Let's say with the Russian business, look, if you chose to stick with the Ukraine on one side or the Russian on the other side, let's say Ukraine in this situation, and you have an office right in Russia, you know, you're gonna receive threats, and you're gonna receive not only mandates, by the way, from the public themselves, but the governments they're in, where you're doing business. So you have to be careful with all those things. Something as a corporation, we really have to think about. So,
yeah, good point. Bring that up on the next slide. That's actually what we want to. So we work in a global environment. Most of the companies that we work with or work for or, you know, interact with, they're global, right? So you have to worry about what's going on around the world. We're going to hit this one event for what's happening with Hong Kong and China. In the last 7 or 8 months, this has been a hotbed for mail threats as they go out. In fact, I think they have like 40-some% of the threats pop up in Asia. And it's going after the government of Hong Kong. Well, it's also going after businesses that support the government, whether they support the Chinese takeover or not. I mean, staying out of the political side of the house. But we have a lot of clients that work in and around that area. And that's a very valid problem that they're trying to come through and deal with. The other thing that comes up with this is there's a lot of drug trafficking in that part of the world when it comes to inside of corporations and companies. So to Carlos's point, you really need to pay attention to where your campuses are at and what's going on around them. And especially when it comes in context of mail, because that's one of the first things that turns. We have a very good friend of the company who likes to say it's a bellwether. Mail is a bellwether. It's something that you can tell if the tide's turning, or you can tell if something's coming at you from a threat perspective based on something is like an indicators like mail, phone call threats, all that other stuff. But mail's a good one. You should tie into it. So corporate is hard oftentimes to get a good idea of what's going on inside of it, because corporations don't self-identify as having problems. This one hit Apple recently. They've got a very, very tight security setup, obviously, and it didn't hit them for very long, but it hits the news. It's national news. And if you start looking at some of these events, they are quite costly. We had a webinar recently. We talked to I'm not saying a name or the company, obviously, but they said, you know, we had to shut down for 14 minutes, and that cost us $300,000 because, you know, Carlos and I were talking earlier about how they count, how you count money, how you account the cost for that. So maybe Carlos, did you hit that? How you figure the cost up?
So yeah, how interesting is it? It's almost down to the second, right? If you have, especially on the tech side of the world, we have engineers that are making $500,000 a year. That's a normal thing where we are. And if you start counting the seconds, how long it takes to be more efficient to do your job. Look, Will, this is the reason why we have food in our offices. So you don't have to go out and actually get food. You can get yourself a snack, a Coke, a water, a food, or hit a restaurant up right next to your office space and not waste the company's time and money. Now, think about this. The mail business is an interesting one, because do we really need to evacuate the entire place in order to take care of it? So in a corporation, or maybe the incident like Apple, let's say if they were able to contain it, they had a training, the proper training, the proper policies to deal with it, or maybe the proper ways to go about it. Maybe we could have just moved a couple of rooms over, or looked at the air conditioning system, making sure the HVAC wasn't connected to one side or the other. Why are we moving people in the other HVAC system? There's so many things that through training and education and obviously good policies. One of the things that I like about you guys is that, like, you don't just come with a product, that you come also with the answer on how to deal with the situation when something happens. So could have, you know, maybe Apple in this case here, as we're seeing, saved a heck of a lot of money if they, you know, had the proper training or understood the movement of either powder or whatever the case may be. within an HVAC system. Not sure, wasn't there, but this is a perfect example on how you can save money by not kicking everybody out of your office for 14 minutes and cost you $300,000 plus.
Yeah, I think they ended up with just a partial. I think they did a pretty good job. The other thing that's interesting about this is it's really hard to back things down. Once you initiate that full emergency action plan and you don't have all the information, or you haven't maybe taken a tactical pause to make a second or third thought process, let run it to the end, it's hard bringing that back. Because once you initiate 911, once you initiate whatever response you initiate, it's something you're going to have to deal with, because they're going to run it all the way through, all the way to the end.
Yeah.
So a couple things that have come up that we've seen in 2022 that are unfortunately probably going to cause more problems. Poor handling of Zoom layoffs. We've seen this. We probably all know the company, that pulled this one. The problem is people are a little, I don't think, sensitive enough to the HR side of the house when it comes to, I could just do something over Zoom or just call this Teams meeting or do whatever. And it's happening over and over and over again. You see companies getting hammered over it. Okay, that's their problem. That's the HR problem. That's the, some of the C-suite issues for doing it. The mail problem on the back end is twofold. One, you've just laid off a bunch of people and then sent them boxes, self-addressed, stamped, paid for, to come back at you. So if you lay off 600 folks through some Zoom and layoff fund, then you end up with 600 suspect packages, because you can bet something strange is coming back in at least one or two of them. The amount of times we hear the word feces in a day-to-day conversation around mail is significant. Work mandates, you've seen this recently with several of major companies where they've stood up on a podium and said, we are going to increase standards or we're going to release people. All right, 100% legit. You can do whatever you want to. Just expect a reaction. And unfortunately, some of that reaction is going to come back towards folks in the mailroom. The same thing with corporate communications. We hit this earlier when we were talking about Roe v. Wade. What do you expect to happen? And unfortunately, many of the people who are the ones that are going to deal with the brunt of the pain aren't the people that are necessarily either we know they're not in charge of the decision. We know they're not in charge of the release of information. They're just the ones in charge of dealing with the response and what comes back over. Again, the same kind of thing ties together with work mandates, but increased pressures on employees have gone up. I've talked to several companies that you have a conversation and their employees are angry. They are mad at the company. They are mad at each other. They are using the communication platforms inside the company to openly talk about how much they don't like it. It's something to pay attention to. What's going on around you? Because a lot of the threats that we see nowadays are also insider. They know how to get into your building. They know how and who to send it to. They don't misspell the CEO's name. There's 15 reasons why that's going to make it that much harder to find.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that. Well, I'm going to call it, mail delivery violence. It's not like workplace violence, but it's kind of like, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
But exactly what we're saying, layoffs. Look, the companies now are asking a lot of folks to return to work. I've worked from home for 2.5 years now. Right? Do I really want to go back to that kind of stress? Where I live, my side of town, man, to drive 7 miles takes me 1.5 hours to get to work, and I got to fight about 20 other vehicles that are trying to cut in front of me. Do I really need that stress? Now, psychologically, I'm seeing a trend on a lot of people taking more psych time off than ever before. And it's really? Because of what's going on today. So psychologically, are we taking care of those folks? And by the way, in the corporate side, if you're not taking care of them right now or having the conversation, hey, listen, we'll come back to work. I understand how difficult it can be for you, for your family, for everything else. We're here to help you. These things can definitely increase, the mail delivery violence. I'm going to call that. It's going to be I don't know if you use that or not, Will. But
it's all you. It's all you, man.
Yeah.
Use the podcast.
There you go, buddy. It's like workplace violence. But so those are the things. Inside of threats go up, more issues come up. And people are just not as, psychologically ready as we used to anymore. So we got to pay attention to that.
And, yeah, it seems to me that some of these things might join together, some of the bullets here, right? If there are layoffs, that's going to be related to economic changes. right? If they're the insider threat could be related to taking a stance on something. And that's almost a catch-22. If you take a stance on something, obviously you're putting your name out there. But if you don't take a stance on something and your employees wish that you would, now you have a potential insider threat on your hands, right? So these things kind of interlink and they all have to sort of be analyzed that way.
And inaction is still an action.
And I'll go back. So if I just look down these bullet points, layoffs. Wow, it is happening right now. In Silicon Valley, where I live and what's going on out here, it's most definitely happened with companies that you never thought, you know, it would happen to. Stocks are down, a lot of issues in the market. So that work mandates, the return to office wasn't even just that, Will. You know, there were people that were quitting and getting upset because they didn't want to take the COVID shot. They, you know, till today, the company's asking, look, if you're going to, one, you have to return to office. Two, in order for you to return to office, you must have your shots, right? And some people never did that, don't want to do it. The corporate communication, societal events is key. How much time are you spending and talking to your people, your team members, on things that happened still in the past 2 years? I mean, the past two and a half years has been a barrage of just from, you know, everything from BLMs to Roe versus Wade to law enforcement, you know, being involved in shootings that were obviously thought as a negative thing. So there's a lot of different things going on, increased pressures. Let me tell you about increased pressures. We worked from home for 2.5 years. And we were kind of, you know, allowed to do what we needed to do, Will, to get work done in the corporate world. But now as we come back, we need to speed the process back up. So that's what I'm hearing now. Listen, we're going to have to work twice as hard to make up for things that we're doing, right? So now the expectation has gone up. So exactly what you're saying, the economic changes, the great resignation in the great recession, what's going on in the world today definitely affects people psychologically. And your life at home is connected to your life at work, Will. I know people say that you can do two different things. I think it's very hard for you to do that unless you're just a psycho, which I'm not. All right. So it has to affect what's going on at work as well. So as companies, we have to pay attention to those things. And most importantly, you know, what's coming in the mail.
Most importantly, what's coming in the mail. With that, you know, all these changes, I think it's interesting. I was talking to not a client of ours, but I was talking to a company, and they said, we're going to fire, we think, 20% of our 20,000 people. And I said, what do you plan on doing? They said, well, because it was over shots. And he said, well, we're going to do this, and we're going to send out FedEx boxes to all of them to get our computers back. And he knew the problem, but he's like, I came from the lawyers. That's what we're doing. And I said, it's not going to be a good idea. And we keep hearing this over and over again. They're like, we're just making our own suspect packages. That's all we're doing. So you might want to talk about a plan before it gets in front of the lawyers and it gets okay on how to do some of these processes.
Yeah. It's funny too, with the psych stuff, man. And I think you mentioned this right in the beginning about drugs coming into the office, which is interesting because look, do you have a drug policy right now? Because I've heard of this before, Will, but not until talking to you, I realized that there's a lot of people getting delivered, you know, their own personal stuff being delivered at work. Yep. Why not do some kind of, you know, drug trafficking, right? It's a lot easier to be delivered in an office than it is at home where your family doesn't know what's going on. People around you don't know what's going on. Nobody in the office is going to open your box. They'll just drop it right on top of your desk and it's usually safe. So, and then, you know, this weird stuff, fentanyl. Fentanyl is like killing everybody. And that's coming through the mail now at a higher rate you can possibly imagine. And you don't need much. You don't need much, right, Will?
No, you don't. And it's interesting. So the conversation, and I asked Carlos, I said, do you have a drug policy? Don't answer, Carlos. We don't need to know your company's answer. But does your company have a drug policy? Before COVID, before we all went our different ways and life really changed, it might be, you know, they'll answer, we get one event a year. One time a year, somebody brings pot in from China or whatever, or from California, if you're not living in a state where it's legal. Now it's 10 or 12. Well, you probably need to look at a policy and start looking at a screening capability that will allow you to find something because you don't want to be a drug trafficker, especially if they start putting it into interoffice mail, because who's responsible for that going through point A to point B? It's paid for by the company. So if you're in charge of that mail room, that facility, it might be something to take a look at.
Interoffice mail. Imagine, you know, private companies getting into federal issues for mailing stuff from
I'll let you know what happened.
Oh, Lord.
All right. Next slide.
So as we move on here, obviously, you know, we're moving into more discussion mode, and that's great. We'll talk about a little, you know, some of the ways to minimize the impact of these threats, right? This has clearly been a problem, as we've established here. What are some of the things that companies can do about it? Before we dive into that, I want to remind everybody, we'd love to hear your questions. We do have a few that have already come into the Q&A box. Thank you very much for those that have submitted those questions. We have plenty of time at the end of that to address, you know, those questions. But as more come up, please throw them in there and we'll get a, you know, back to them at the end of this thing. So as we move on here, guys, can you take us through how to minimize the impact of all these threats we're talking about today?
So a lot of the military stuff kind of has seeped into the corporate world that I find myself surrounded in. And you'll hear if you're wearing a uniform all the time, TTPs, tools, techniques, and procedures. And, you know, really it comes down to, if you need equipment to get the task done, what proper tool do you get to do that? How do you use it? And then how do you implement it? The big thing that we come up with, these four main points, and I really want Carlos to ring in on some of this, because he is a practitioner, is involved in implementing this on many more levels than just mail. And I think it applies across. And I think one of the things that people maybe don't think about is you're already doing this type of stuff in different parts of your facility, in different aspects of your security life. They just need to be applied to a logistical function like the mailroom, like, you know, training. We do training, right, Carlos? You actually do stuff with your people all the time.
Absolutely. You know, it's funny too, on the corporate side, a lot of times we jump in and we'll say, well, you know, we just don't have the money to do training. Like one of the easiest things, you know, we break off into you know, meetings right in the beginning of every shift on every security position or every trade-off of shift, you know, the handoff. All you need is about 5 minutes of a quick conversation on what's going on, a quick sharing of this specific item or whatever it is that you're training on that. That's really all you need. So the excuse is not really there anymore, Will. And can we do a little bit of training on these things? Second thing is, for a lot of the corporations and people that are listening right now, do you have an education program? A program within your corporation that's kind of like a see something, say something program that creates sentinels, not just out of the security folks, but everyone that's in your building that understands, you know, what is suspicious packages, what is a suspicious person, vehicle, all those kinds of things are extremely important, because I want to create sentinels out of everyone, right? There's very little security folks, a lot of folks, team members that are out there in the office. Why not do that? And as you said here, switched on employees, I just call them sentinels. You know, I want them to be ready to help me, however the case may be. So maybe we'll really focus in on at least an education program for all of the employees might be a good beginning here as you lead to the second half of 2022 into 2023.
Yeah, I used the term switched on, but again, that's seeping from my previous life. But the reality that we see incident after incident, time after time, is that it's not generally the security lead, the one who's got the training, the one who's got the capabilities and can affect change, who's stuck holding something. It's the person working in the mailroom, usually with 5 minutes left on a shift because it was delivered by a courier at the end of the day, and they're trying to figure out how to handle it because they're alone in the building. That's usually what happens. And if you don't power down the capability to at least make small decisions that they know are safe to make, because management is involved and management supports them when it comes to safety, security, you know, quality of life, duty of care, that stuff, they're probably going to put it down and walk away. If they don't have the ability to affect change and fix things, like, I know this doesn't look right, it doesn't feel right, I'll deal with this tomorrow when somebody who's in charge can handle it. And then who knows what's sitting there for an extra 12, 14 hours.
Oh, not even that, you know, it's not really my problem. I got to go home. I just delivered this thing, get out of the way. I didn't see anything suspicious.
Oh, there you go. Even more. Yeah. Walk it upstairs.
Yeah. I don't see anything suspicious.
Do the way out.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
So another good part is, if you look at screening, like, look at it as a practice. It's actually a technique. It's not necessarily something you have to put a bunch of equipment at. Most things are caught because of the human intuition. Somebody's gut sat there and said, this doesn't look right. Even the first time it comes in, all right, this one looks kind of strange. Somebody's smart enough to go, I'm going to write this person's name down and add it to the list. If you go to many, many mailrooms, there's usually a hand scrawled list on the wall of people that the crazies that have sent stuff in, with a little bit of feedback on what exactly came in and what it was for and who it was to. It might need to be codified. And that will increase your screening capability because people then realize that I should add to this list. I should put more information on here. We should track this. And I'm going to quote Chuck Randolph again. I mean, he's got a great little way of talking about weather or mail. It's a key. It'll let you know that something's going on. It's something to pay attention to.
Absolutely. Good old Chuck. Love Chuck. And he's always got good comments. If you ever go down to Phoenix, go say hi to Chuck, man. He's a good guy. But I think you're right. Screen is the practice. Equipment supporting is the tool. How great is, can I use that? Well,
George, man.
No, thank you, buddy.
You're on the distro list. All the slides will go out.
You got it, buddy. All right. Thanks a lot, man.
And the other thing is you're looking at tools. The cost of these events is significant. Like, and I know most people on here, you don't have a huge budget that you can go do things with, but the cost of some of these events, people don't understand until afterwards. We usually have people come to us after an event and they'll say, "Oof, man, we know the cost of it now, and we don't want to have that happen again. So we're going to implement a program." In fact, we start doing, talking to brand new clients. That's one of the first questions we've had. What's happened to you and how much did it cost? And, they're not going to answer that question all the time, but oftentimes the answer is, "Ooh, you should have seen how mad everybody upstairs was, because we should have seen it. It came through, and once it got there, somebody found it." But the cost of it is usually, like I said, way more than the cost of what it's going to cost to put a program in place, train some people, get them motivated, get management involved, and come up with some sort of solution that works best for your company.
So there's a question, Will, that I just pulled up. How do you quantify putting in a new security protocol or equipment versus the risk of doing nothing? I usually go right to the operation. And by the way, I just don't use 1 year CapEx. I use a 3, 5, 10 year plan on my return on investment on whatever the security, the new security minimum standard that I need to put in place needs to get done. So going back to the engineer problem that I have, if every engineer costs me $500,000 and per second they cost me $120, right? Then obviously I can make that into a mathematical equation, multiply by the amount of engineers that work within the building, so on and so forth. And that shows automatically the return investment on, even if I were to step off in the case of the other company talked about 14 minutes. So that's one of the ways that I do it. But I also do a return on investment on the CapEx side, not just on that year, but I extend it. Look, we're going to be able to use this product for 3 years before we even have to replace it. Right. Yeah. So I divide that by 3 years, man, and I keep on going. There's a lot of different ways of showcasing equipment in a way that'll support your security business by challenging back the operational cost of not having it. If anybody's ever got questions, let me know. We'll talk more about it. But yeah, that's the one way that I do.
That'd be a good topic for your podcast, actually.
There you go.
Sure. That's a good life.
And, I think you could probably include into that things like if it hits the news cycle and now your stock price is going to be affected by it and, this panic involved, right? The ramifications could go beyond just minutes outside the building. Right?
Oh, TJ, now see, you guys got to stop this, man. Now I got to go into listen. Is it just regional, right? The news, is it just regional? Is it just state? Is it North America? Is it globally? How long has it been? Has it been 1 week, 1 month it's going to stay in the news cycle, or is it going to be an entire half a year? So all of those you have to be able to measure through risk. That's a whole other conversation, TJ, man, but let's do it one day. That'd be fun.
Yeah. That'd be a good one. All right, I think we're
up. All right, excellent, guys. As we move on, we'll open it up for all the questions. We do have a number of them here. Thank you very much for everybody submitting those. You can see also on the screen here, we have additional resources. We'd love to send some of these out to you. Everybody on the webinar today is going to get copies of the report and a few other things. So we will get those over to you. We do have a few extra minutes, so we'll go into the questions. We could probably, if we pull down the screen share, we can just kind of go into discussion mode between the three of us here. Again, still plenty of time. Please keep the questions coming in and we'll get to them as they come in here. So I'll go all the way back to one of the earlier questions we got here from earlier part of the discussion. The question says, we're seeing religious groups speaking out on social issues and with regional and global impact. And many of these groups do not have any mail screening. What would you recommend to these organizations? All right. So I'm going to expand that into maybe just a smaller org. Carlos, you mentioned mom and pop, right? So anybody that might not be this multinational corporation with a huge budget for mail screening and security, if we think a little smaller, what can groups along those lines do to minimize impact or, up their screening, that kind of thing?
So stick with the religious thing for a second. There are grants. There's a lot of stuff that that religious organizations can go out and get for physical security, especially after, you know, like the it's state and national synagogue shootings last year. All the times that this has been something that's come up because people tend to go after religious groups. We know that. We see it happen in the mailroom environment. There are programs in place to help out with that. But inside of a smaller organization to include churches, the fact of just getting somebody a little bit of training is critical. Getting somebody whatever equipment they could possibly, that would be best for them to use is great. But training and emphasis on what's probably coming at them, I think for a small organization, the best thing you can do. The human is a great defensive tool.
I agree. I remember even going back, you know, the post office can help you out with some stuff. I know that you guys, Race Secure, can help out even with some training materials. And I'm sure if somebody reached out to you, you'll be able to answer some of their questions for them more personally. But you're right. So there's multiple grants out there. And going back to that educational program to create sentinels right out of your folks, this is a perfect example on how we can do it. We can do it really quick through a conversation of, you know, suspicious boxes, suspicious mail. What does it look like usually? What's some of the differences about it? What's the weight like? Is it moving in there? Is it wet? Like all the stuff that we learned throughout our history, education is key. But I like, you know, I didn't think about the grants, Will, but I like that you can actually go, especially now in the community. Another thing that I learned too, a lot of the church groups, my wife is Jewish. And the Jewish community, at least the churches, they literally have security folks, like directors of security that have a region or an area. I mean, they're going as far as that these days, which I thought was quite interesting. I met a couple of them, and they have tremendous backgrounds. It was pretty incredible. But education, start there. I think it'll be key. Great question, Rhett.
Mm-hmm. There's a second question here that might be similar to that. Maybe if we expand a little bit, it says, any recommendations on good suspicious mail training for the corporate environment? So Carlos, you mentioned that is something that Race Secure does. If I could take a quick plug on that, that is something we can absolutely help with. Please, you know, reach out to us. We'd be happy to talk to you about that. We're already in discussions with a few organizations that kind of bridge the gap on the nonprofit side to do exactly that. But it is something that we specialize in for exactly this reason. But what else might be out there, guys, that we could recommend if there's other options that folks can look at?
As Carlos mentioned, oftentimes you get the postal inspector guys to come out to take a look at what you're doing and help out. It's hard to pin them down, but if you can, good. There are some decent online trainings that go on, and it's becoming more and more of a mainstream problem. People are seeing it, and they're starting to put together their own programs. The other thing I would say, honestly, is reach out to your peers. A lot of companies have already cracked the proverbial nut, or you don't have to reinvent the wheel. If they've got a program that's working, they probably have media. They probably have something else already in place that would help. Working amongst your peers is a fantastic solution for quick problems that you don't have to deal with over and over and over again.
Yeah, it's a benchmarking. So there used to be a saying that I still use till today that I learned on a prior company of mine: security and safety is never a leading edge in our business. And I should openly and freely share whatever information, because if it affects me, it'll affect the person next to you. Actually, I'll give them credit, the Disney company. I worked with them for 21 years, and safety and security should never be a leading edge, especially in our business. And we used to openly share with Universal Studios, SeaWorld, everything that we were doing, because look, if something happened at Disney, right, that local market in Central Florida, it'd be done. Nobody's coming out of SeaWorld, nobody's coming out to Universal, right? Legoland. So a lot of those things are important. So yes, benchmarking, communicating with the other, creating relationships, even on LinkedIn, you know, a lot of that's used today. I think that's a great way to go about learning and figuring out what can you do as a corporation to keep your people secure.
Yeah, that's great intel. All right. So again, going back to some of the earlier stats here that Will, you were sharing with us at the top of the hour. Yep. Question here about the powders and liquids that we're seeing. It says, what are some of the most common white powders and dangerous liquids that will get sent through the mail or packages? So as you track some of these statistics, I know they don't always name what the substance is, but you know, you and your security team here at Race Secure do a lot of that data crunching. So what can you tell us about those harmful substances?
When they don't report what it is, you report how they responded, because that's in essence effective. If they're out there with a full-blown hazmat team doing a decontamination, you assume they're thinking it's ricin or something along those lines. what it actually is. Oftentimes when I got out of uniform in 2019 and we started looking at white powder threats, 99.8% of the time, and I'm not giving a real number, but it's massively the most amount, it was benign. It was talcum powder, it was this, it was that, it was whatever. What we've seen in the last probably 9 to 10 months increase significantly is caustic soda or super tropical bleach, powdered bleach, because it'll burn on the other end. Even something as weird as wasabi. People take wasabi powder, they'll put it in as the white powder thing because wasabi gets in your nose and you have a physical reaction to it. That's where wasabi's hot. It's in your nose, not on your tongue. And so when you have that reaction, people end up at the hospital. If you look and read many of the events happen, but you'll look at the end of it, it'll say 3 people were taken to the hospital, 1 first responder had a response. Okay, when they do all that and they get done, then they're released without injury. Well, they went in for some reason. Nobody stands up and says, please give me an ambulance ride. I want to go hang out with, you know, the EMT for a while. The other thing that's coming up that's dangerous is fentanyl. Now, fentanyl is in every form you can imagine it. You'll see it, everything from soaked into paper, moved into pills, pressed in to look like Viagra, pressed in to look like everything else. It is extremely dangerous and people are overdosing all over. The other reality of it is you have to inhale, ingest, inject, or somehow absorb it in or through your skin or through a mucous membrane for it to get to you. So touching it isn't going to cause a huge, it can, but there's got to be a very, very specific scenario. But that's something that I would worry about more than anything else right now. Is if you're sitting there with a pile of white powder somewhere in your office, you should make the assumption that it is something as dangerous as fentanyl.
Well, I saw the correctional facility numbers that you had too. Mm-hmm. And stepping away for 1 second in the corporate side, I hope the correctional facilities are seeing this because, God, you know, if you could pass fentanyl that easily as almost anything, right? I can just imagine what's going on that side of the earth.
I spend a lot of time in prisons helping out because we're starting to get into that.
Nobody needs to know about your criminal background.
They let me out at the end of every day. That's the different part. Yeah. But they've got everything from soaked paper where it's coming through with its legal documentation. They've got it. It is bad. And I've talked to security directors who say that the people, 3 overdoses in 1 prison, and they go talk to prisoners who they know have it. It's like, I don't care. It's the best high ever. I'm going to use it again. Even though 3 people on the same batch died, if I can get my hands on that pill, I'm going to take it. And that's what they're having to deal with.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
All right. So again, going back to some of the earlier stuff, we're talking about international events kind of having an impact here. So this question says, we've heard of businesses that are perceived as Russian, right? If you want to talk Russia, yep. Ukraine, even though the company itself, it might not be Russia or hasn't been operating there in years. But the perception, the public view is that you're tied to this, right? So this might be another example of your name getting dragged into a conversation that you really don't belong in, but it doesn't matter. The court of public opinion has already convicted you. How do we mitigate threats is the question here, based on a perceived stance the company might take or might not have actually taken. So what do we do about some of the brand issues there? Or, how do you think a little bigger in the security field?
I'll take this one. So going back again to that geopolitical stuff and the U.S. political scene today, if you're making decisions or appearing to make decisions that contradict or go against or go with or whatever it is that's going on in some kind of political stage, then you have to be careful. The perceived stuff, thank God we have internal and external communicators within a lot of these companies. You have to communicate and make the world aware. You literally have to beat the system. Social media today, information moves so fast that it's extremely hard sometimes to even catch up to it. And you almost, as a company, have to create your kind of advertisement or marketing or whatever it is that you're answering to as fast as social media can. So that's one way of fighting it. Especially, I'd love to ask this question to the person that put this up, which is, what do you mean perceived? Perceived as a Russian company or perceived to have made the statement? I might have read that a little bit different, but perceived to have made a statement that either agree or disagree with a geopolitical issue.
Yeah, and I think both of those could potentially, right, do that court of public opinion, have that effect, right? Whether you were looking at history and the name of your company or just a perceived stance, the downstream effects might end up being similar there.
Yeah, you know, mitigating reputation too is extremely hard, and we all try to do that in the corporate security world. It's like, but how do you mitigate reputation, right? You have to measure how long it'll stick around and how well of communications you can make. So crisis communication, there you go.
So I talk to companies all the time, and one of the things that we talk about is like, you have to do a continual risk assessment on your company. One of the best ways that I mean, it's not a thing you would ever physically do, but walk out take your access badge off, toss it on your desk. Take your phone with you, the one that you can Google anything with, not the corporate phone that they monitor what you're looking at. Yeah. Walk out the front door, close it, and sit on the park bench out front and Google your own company and see what comes up. See what social media is saying about your organization from the outside looking in. And I've had a couple people we talked to after that come back, like, I didn't realize that we had done this, because you're inside of a microcosm. You're inside of a small, I mean, huge companies, you're still just getting, you're not seeing everything, but you're also inside your own little world and you don't know what the other side of the company's doing. And so people will sit there like, your company said this 2 weeks ago. The guy's like, dude, I don't know anything about that.
Yeah.
But you're the one dealing with whatever's coming in. So
if your leader is not looking at Google Alerts and you don't have your company name on it, like, you're really failing yourself. Right, because you get a nice email every morning as you're having a little coffee before you go to work, and you get a chance to see, all right, what's happening with my company today? So Google Alerts for me, it's key.
I do it. I do. Yeah. Same thing.
Yep.
So a number of questions here. I'll kind of relate back to the corporate policies that we've described. And with an eye on the clock here, I want to respect some folks' time. So I'm going to do one question unrelated to the corporate culture, and then I want to come back to a series of questions all related to that. But the unrelated one is actually about the major couriers, right? And everybody knows their name. We've all gotten the packages delivered by all of these corporations, but I won't actually name any names here. But if you think to all the major, courier companies out there, the question is about how often do they scan packages, right? What level of screening or security are they providing before delivering that cardboard box to your front steps or to your office? So Will, again, I know you pay quite a bit of attention to this. So what can you tell us about security provided by those companies?
The person behind the counter is usually the one that catches it if it's illegal, because it's a private company, they don't have to do it. But once it gets in the process, it's gone. So any package that goes over about 150, 180 miles, regardless of how it goes, will go through air. So it will go through TSA screening in bulk. They'll run an x-ray machine around, they'll run a dog around or something, but it's getting delivered. That's the reason why the USPS is the largest drug trafficker in the United States, and Canada Post is in Canada, because nobody's looking. They are looking, but they're not looking at everything you see. The private companies, they're there to make money. If you ask DHL, you go into Atlanta and you say, hey, what happens if we stop, a screen and we slow this plane down for 2 hours? And their answer is that 2 hour delay could be a 3 to 5 or 7 day delay by the time we get this package out to the southeast corner of Africa where it's supposed to go. And we're here to make money. That means moving that package as fast as possible. The reality is, if the addressee's on there, it's going to get there.
I was going to say, not long ago, there was a study when I was looking at screening, where I came from, we did a lot of screening just because of the amount of people that were coming through. I remember a study with like the TSA. Now, everybody has to remember this. I'm not just talking about TSA. It's all the companies that TSA hires a lot of times to do the TSA work. At airports, they were missing things 97% of the time.
Of the time.
Yep. 97. Remember the study came out a couple of years ago, right?
Yeah, I remember. Externally evaluated. Yeah.
Right. So as you're talking about the mail, the system, the couriers, I'm like, man, I can almost say that could possibly be about the same measurement.
Yep.
So I don't know. Good stuff. Wow.
It's bad when they have to admit that when they look at themselves as an 85% failure rate.
The funny thing is, I told my wife this. This is how it affects. I told my wife, they're gonna miss out. They're only gonna get 3% of the time. My wife freaked out. Why do I need to fly ever again, honey?
All right. So a few questions here all relate to corporate culture. If folks do have a few extra minutes to stick around with us, we appreciate that. If not, if you have to get back to the rest of your day, we understand. And thank you for joining us thus far. But these questions all sort of relate back to corporate culture, right? So if we, we talked a bit about, the stress of going back to work and, Carlos, your tragic commute and all that stuff. But the question here is about with the increase in stress and how that may increase things like workplace violence, would it be wise of a company to look at things like mental health insurance as a benefit for employees? And would that be a good thing for security? Does that have trickle down effects for the security world? And if yes, how would you make that argument up the food chain to the powers that be? So obviously we're a bit outside the scope of security directly, but you know, as we see, there's still kind of some downstream effects. So Carlos, you want to weigh in on some of the corporate angle there?
I was trying to find a question at the same time you were reading it, and then I'm looking up, and then all of a sudden it disappeared. Can you just give me the gist of it, and I'll get it.
Sure. So it says, with the increase in stress and how that may increase workplace violence, would putting mental health insurance as a benefit be good for security? So, and if yes, how do you best make that argument to the people in charge?
So it's really interesting because every time I've ever had medical insurance to my company, I had the ability to have psych people. And I'm going to be wide open. I've used, till today, I use, my Dr. Ari, by the way, is my guy. And I talk to him about once every 2 weeks. So you have to look at your insurance premiums and make sure that it's already not in there. Because I don't think I've ever worked for a company. Now, mom and pop companies, maybe, TJ, that could be something that they want to look at. Would I do it? I most definitely would do it, especially today in the world that we're in today. I think that extra premium that the company would pay to be able to give somebody 50 visits with someone to talk to, it will change really the, not first of all, the perception, right? Like the company really cares about me, one, which is good. That's all we want about, right? I could save face and have some dignity where I can just look out and go find help myself. And I don't have to go tell my job that I'm just having a lot of issues, because you don't have to tell anyone. You go and you do it yourself. Right. Mm-hmm. So would I do it, man? Absolutely. Especially in today's world. And I would almost use this kind of stuff, workplace violence numbers that have gone up, as we know, insider threats issues that have gone up, as you already know. Mathematically, if I'm selling this as an HR representative, selling it back to the company, I would just pull those numbers up, you know, and say, look, this is what's going on in the world.
Yeah.
Right. That's how I would go about it.
So, and there's other positive aspects too. I mean, if you look at, I'm not going to say his name, but friend of the company, he asked another question right behind it. And he's talking about periodic health checks, mental health checks, and making sure you actually do background checks on folks. It is another way to gauge the health of the organization. And with that, HR should probably be on board. If you're willing to take the high stress people and put them in an environment where they might be helped, where they can actually improve what they do and increase the level of safety, because they typically own the safety for the entire organization. I mean, we talk about everybody being a sentinel, right? But there's those that are charged with that task, and people who have some of the key roles, it might be a very, very good idea to make sure that they're A, getting background checks regularly to make sure they haven't slipped off and had started having bigger problems. The one that our friend mentions is talking about schizophrenic, but a little bit less maybe on the extreme than that, that having the ability to have that backstop in place, you would think an HR department would think that would be very positive.
Yeah. And you know, what else is interesting related to that question, Will, is that, this question mentions that it was a male vendor that had these employees, right? It wasn't even the corporation employees. It was, a vendor, it was a third party. And so this it comes into contracts now, right? When you're hiring vendors and things, right, you can negotiate with them to look at their employees.
But DJ, that's one of the keys that companies have to think about today. Here's another angle on that, okay? If you're hiring third-party vendors, wherever it is, to do whatever work, if they're not matching the same, the same kind of things that you're giving to your full-time employees, first of all, you start creating a huge differentiating between third-party vendors and full-time employees. And that's bad. That's bad for culture and everything else. So I think today companies should not be hiring any third-party company that is not willing to do the same that they're willing to do for their employees. That's just me and my idea, because it would just be nothing but issues, moving ahead, which then goes into workplace violence, right? And all this other stuff, mail-in crap, right? So thesis. Right.
Yep. We deal with a lot of third-party vendors, and that problem comes up a lot.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's not fair and equitable.
Yeah, and you mentioned the culture, Carlos. There's a question here along those lines, and I'm going to roll that one back into just how we sort of look at the big picture, right? Not just bottom line, not just ROI, not just protocols and procedures, but treat everybody like they're a person, and how we can kind of make those things all fit together and look big picture, right?
Yeah. So think about this. COVID-19, a lot of companies did the right thing and they kept on the third party vendors and they treated them as their full time employee. But there was a lot of companies out there that did not, you know, they treated them literally like second class citizens. So here we go. Here's the issues, right? The issues start coming around when that happened.
That's right. So let me add one to that. And this is not story time, but one of the companies that we talked to recently, throughout the entire COVID experience, a third party vendor is the one that kept the facility up and running. There was three of their people that were in there working every day, and well, every third day, but three people running it for a very major, you know, organization. And then they canceled the contract at pretty much the end of COVID. And those three employees were extremely upset, but they did it right. And then they hired them on to the primary company. Can you imagine being the three employees that kept a $1 billion company going? And then you get cut off at the end. You've been there through the entire COVID experience and not have somebody take care of you. That would have been a heck of an insider threat.
Yeah. Agreed.
So the two final questions we have here, and there is still an extra minute or two if folks want to add last minute, but one question about RaceSecure in particular, do we work with companies in Latin America and do they usually face the same type or magnitude of problems? So Will, I know you're tracking all these threats, international and domestic. So I assume the answer is yes, but you know, can you say anything more about that?
Yeah, the answer is yes. And the other answer is they have different problems. So you have a lot of drugs, nothing's going on, but you also have a higher probability of dealing with a bomb, higher probability of dealing with caustic materials that are sent intentionally. That's it's a little bit less. I don't know which country we're talking about, but the aggressiveness level is a little higher in South America if you look at the overall event.
I just saw who asked that question, and Ari is an incredible security professional down in Argentina.
Okay.
So it's, good question.
Mm-hmm. And then a question about the technology that RaceSecure is so proud of here. A question of having the RaceSecure device, it's called the MailSecure, integrated into another security system under one platform. So I know that there's, you know, quite a bit of integration that our team is working on, but Will, what can you say about, you know, collecting some of those things under one umbrella?
Yeah, we've done that with a few of our clients where we pulled up their other imagery systems and pushed through it. If it's got a USB outlet or the ability to pull data out of it, we can push it through one platform. Then reach out to us on it. That's kind of independent upon. There's thousands and thousands of multiple, you know, triggers, sensors and hardware out there. So that might be a more independent or offline question.
Yep. Excellent segue. If you've got questions about how RaceSecure can help in our technology, our service, please do reach out. We'd be happy to talk to you. But gentlemen, that kind of concludes our day. So thank you, Carlos, for joining us on the webinar today.
Thank you, brother Carlos.
Thank you. It was awesome. I appreciate it, gents. Yep.
And Will, as always, thank you for your expertise. So thank you, everybody, for joining, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks, everybody.
See ya.
Bye-bye.